Here we are back on the Land Rover. I've been putting this bit off, scrubbing the rust and paint off the driver's side tow box. I knew there was a little bit of rust this side. It was quite rusty under the paint, and I'm just in the process of stripping off the remaining paint, having scraped off as much as I could. It's mostly solid. Unfortunately, this seam down here, water's got in and that's starting to blow apart, but I knew that from looking at it inside. Ultimately, I want to have a galvanised bulkhead on this vehicle eventually, so what I'm doing here is just trying to clean it all up the best I can and preserve it, get maybe another 5 years out of it. But actually, surprisingly, the rust has only been, I suppose it's not surprising, only confined to this corner, because that's where it gets the water off the wheel. But all of this in here, which was coated in bitumen, I scraped all the bitumen off and it's rust-free underneath, really good. So I'm just stripping the remainder of the paint that I couldn't scrape, and all this lower half is going to get rubbed back, the rust treated, and it's going to get painted. And then from here downwards, a coat of heavy bitumen underseal once that's all dry, and we're just going to get a coat of paint on top here as well. Just in case you're wondering, this is the paint stripper that I use. Forget the nitrile stuff, it's absolutely useless. This stuff is quite industrial, and it goes without saying you need to be a bit careful with it, but it does the job. One tip: if you have this stuff, leave it stored with the cap slightly loose. You'll thank me for it when you get to summer. I spent quite a bit of time on the paint stripping and got back to bare metal everywhere that I could, and then got some 80 grit sandpaper, rubbed it back, mechanically removed as much of the rust as I could, so I was kind of just left with the pitting. I've now got some cure rust on there, which hopefully will make that more stable. I think that's going to be about the best I can do, and then paint it. I'm going to get in there with the red oxide and just do the bits I've treated anywhere there was rust, and then we'll get the NATO green out, brush a few coats of that on. Yeah, it'd be interesting to see how it does. And when all that's done, I've got some dinner trawl to go down in the door pillar, which is in amazing condition. You normally almost expect to see holes at the bottom, and the foot there particularly, it's all in particularly good condition. Now, I did manage to save some old hinge bolts from down in there, so they're no longer rattling around in there. So that's the rusty areas treated now. So the rust has been stabilised. I've got rid of it, as much of it as I can. It's not too bad actually. So I've just done a very basic job of masking off, and I'm going to just get a squirt of red oxide primer on there, let that dry so it's all protected overnight, and carry on painting tomorrow. Yeah, it's not perfect, but I think it's as good as I can do here. And pleasingly, most of it is actually very good metal. It's just that seam there that I'm not really happy with. I suppose in an ideal world I'd actually cut that off and replace it, but that's, yeah, 40 years old, it's done quite well. Well, hopefully you'll appreciate, not quite my usual standard, but it's really just to preserve it all a bit. You know, the masking tape wouldn't even stick, it's so cold today. Not a lot of fun, but the main thing is we've treated that rust. So if I can get this to dry today, I'll get a coat of NATO green on it, probably a couple of coats in the end. Yeah, I might go and get a hot air gun and an extension reel and just see if I can speed it up a bit. So once again, we seem to be deviating from the subject of brakes and steering, but in a roundabout sort of way, we'll come back to that. I'm trying to do as many things as I can whilst it's in bits. Now seems like a really good time to do it. So one of the things that I've always lacked in the vehicle is some proper auxiliary sockets. Some would say not necessarily in keeping with a classic vehicle, but if it's in regular use and it does travel some distance, so you go away camping and that sort of thing like I do, it's quite useful to have these things, and I'm not averse to little modifications like this. So I got some, well, it was a triple socket set from Car Builder Solutions, but it was all on a plastic backing. So I made up this one just out of a scrap of aluminium. I turned some aluminium bezels and I finished the lot in VHD crackle black again. I think that should look quite good. I've got this one as well, which is a like a phone charger socket, a USB thing, and that's going to go in the centre binnacle hopefully. I also want to fit a little interior light kind of somewhere up in the dash, just discreetly. I'm not sure whether I should actually fit that or not, but I've got it. You find these in, I think, MGBs and Austin Allegros and things like that. It had a chrome like reflector on it, but I've done that in black as well, just to dull it down a bit. Obviously it's still chrome on the inside. So we'll see if we can find a home for that. We've got also an oil pressure and water temperature gauge to fit, but more on that later. So a few little modifications and upgrades, and more to take apart, unfortunately. First job is to have the redundant PDWA valve wiring out, so let's go and have a look at that. Pretty chilly in here today. It's about 2 degrees out this morning, had a very hard frost overnight. That's where we got to. So the next thing to do over there really is to do a lot of cleaning and get it as clean inside the dash tray as we can get it. Lots of detritus in there, and maybe try and get some preserving wax in there to take care of the dashboard. But we'll come back to that. So today's job is to initially take out this centre binnacle and try and remove the redundant wiring for the PDWA valve. It appears to have connections to the ignition barrel, takes its feed from there, one to the fuse box, and there's a little loom that goes off in the engine bay which plugged into the valve switch unit, and it seems to run back this way to a little relay in here. And as far as I can see, all that does is illuminate the light of doom, which is no longer in use. They're quite troublesome things, and they make what is already quite a difficult brake system to bleed even harder, so I took mine out years ago. This dash binnacle as well, we can do a bit of restoration on this while it's out. It's not the tidiest, so maybe a little bit of paint just to clean it up. It's held in with 4 screws, the 2 at the top and then another 2 in that location, so we should be able to get that forward. I may very well do what I've done over the other side and just remove the switch units from the panel and take the panel away, which saves unearthing all the wiring. We've got to take this little plastic binnacle out, which will expose the back of the ammeter. There's actually 3 holes for gauges in there, but we'll come back to that. And we've then got to get this dash tray out in order to run the cable under it back into the dashboard area. So quite a bit to do, but it's all fairly easy stuff. So since the last update, I've also cleaned up the bulkhead. I'll throw in some pictures of how I did that. There was quite a bit of rust in this area, and then this seam here, which hasn't gone too far. It's not perfect, as you can see, but I've got lots of rust converter in there once I'd cleaned off as much as I could mechanically. So it's all a lot better. And the last job will be, once all this has had some time to dry, is a bit of bitumen under seal under there. So you can see here the loom that went to the PDWA valve, which disappears off in the dash, and that's the plug that went on the switch, and black and white appears to be the switch line. So let's see what we've got inside. Alright, so the centre binnacle's stripped out. Again, it looks like a rat's nest, but it's not very complicated. We've got the plug there for the fog light switch. We've got that's for the hazard light switch. We've got one here for the fog light switch, that's the yellow and red. And then all of this, oh, there's a warning light, absolutely no idea what that does. all of this is for the PDWA valve, and then more warning lights. No idea what any of them do, but they flash at various times, like when you activate the indicators, that sort of thing. In fact, I think one of these is actually for the fog light. When you switch the fog lamp on, that comes on. Anyway, what I want to know is where all of this goes. And so you can see this black and white wire here that we saw in the engine bay, one on this fuse line to the relay, and one here that goes to the warning light. So that all makes sense. The white, I think, is a feed from the fuse box, and the white with red flash should be an ignition line, if I've got my colour codes right. So it obviously activates the relay when you switch on the ignition, and it's got a power feed from the fuse box. I think that's it, but what I'm going to do is take this binnacle out and then the dash tray and just have a look and actually trace it right through before I go and rip it all out. But it would be nice to get rid of all that, as it's redundant but live, never a good thing. And then we can look at restoring this centre binnacle a bit, which has really seen better days, hasn't it? As for the fog lights, you may not have these on your Series 3, I think they're only on later ones. These are what the switches look like. I think these are actually quite rare, so we shall make some efforts to clean that up. They're worth looking after now. And that is the hazard light switch. So the dashboard tray is fairly easy to get out. We'll give that a really good clean up while it's out. It's quite dusty. It's quite a flexible plastic, so you can sort of bend it round things and be fairly brutal with it. Anyway, it's all in reasonable condition under there, just a bit dirty, so we'll clean up everything we can while it's out. So the PDWA valve wiring, this is the loom for it, which runs under that tray, and you've got these two wires here, and they do indeed go to the fuse box, the white one, and the ignition live, the white with red flash. So I need to feed back the engine bay side through the grommet, and then we can actually remove all that, and that'll be a bit more space made in there. It may be possible actually to kind of strip down this loom and use some of the wires for my new auxiliary sockets. Yeah, it might be worth a look. There we are, all that totally redundant. So I'm now just going to give this dash tray a clean out. Yeah, it's not very rusty in there actually, which is quite surprising. I'm going to have a look and see what that actually is. No idea, but we can probably safely terminate it better than that. And then I think the two 12 volt sockets are going to go about there for sat nav and dash cam. Oil and coolant gauge there. Haven't quite decided there or there yet, because that's already damaged, that side, so it might actually remove that broken piece. And then I think the phone charger socket can go up in this here, about where that repair panel is, so we can probably get rid of that. Lots more cleaning and fiddling about to do. I've just pulled the ammeter out. The bulb has a tendency to fall out of the back, so we need to crimp that holder up. But also the gauge is looking really rather scabby, so we'll take that in the workshop and restore it. This is obviously an aftermarket fitment. I guess it was fitted because it's a military vehicle. A lot of these CLs were actually converted to radio trucks in service, and sometimes then put back to original spec. They were adapted to do whatever was needed at the time, and I've got a military handbook for these vehicles dated at the time this vehicle was built, and it says as much, and it shows that things like this were fitted just to allow the fitment of radio kit and that kind of thing. I think sometimes the ammeter formed a bit of a junction point, but all of this wiring, these heavy cables, is what looks like a sort of second loom disappearing through the bulkhead into the engine bay, and it is just for the ammeter. So we could actually get quite a bit more wiring out, but it is part of the vehicle, so I'm going to keep it. There you go. I can imagine a full military spec 24 volt is actually quite complicated electrically. I had to deviate from my plan slightly. I was going to put the dual power sockets just here. However, the dashboard is, it's obviously made so that bits and pieces can be pushed out and certain fittings installed. And the dashboard doesn't actually have steel all the way in that area. There's like a couple of little slots is the best I can describe it up there. But anyway, the metal that runs across there is narrower than this in the vertical plane. So that's no good. So I've elected to fit my little plate and sockets there, which I think will be fine, and it will keep it out of the way of what is actually quite a congested area. They're not very spacious vehicles. The handbrake's always in the way. The gear lever will come about over there anyway. So this will probably be the better option. Anyway, so what I'm going to do is get the hole cutter and hog a couple of holes in the dash panel. Obviously pushing the wiring well out of the way first. That's the first sockets installed. I'm quite happy with those. I've just got a straight edge along this bit here to get the alignment. It's about a quarter inch of foam on the dashboard, so that's the reason for the little spreader plate. And I decided I would fit the little bezels, have a chunkier look. And also it doesn't then intrude into the dash tray so far. Okay, I've made up a little basic wiring loom, I suppose, for my new sockets. It's a fairly thin gauge wire, but things like my sat-nav draws like 500 milliamps or something. Absolutely nothing, so it doesn't need to be anything spectacular. And it minimises the space it takes up. It's easier to bend round things deep down in the dashboard. So this is my socket that's going to be up on the centre panel, and the other cable spurs off that. That'll be the bit that tucks through the hole there, so it's nicely protected. And then we've got these two here, which will go onto my extra socket that we've just fitted. So I'm probably going to have to put a little hole in the dashboard tray and poke all that through. Anyway, I'm quite pleased with that. And so long as I'm not running tyre compressors and things like that off it, it'll be absolutely up to the job. Just in the process of restoring the ammeter at the moment. It's a bit of a devil to get apart like the main instruments were, but it's cleaned up quite nicely. So the centre binnacle. There are a few things wrong with this. Mainly it just needs a bit of tidying up. Previous owner, he hacked a big hole in it. It was a big jagged rectangle, if you can call it that. God knows what he did it with. A Stanley knife or something, and a pair of pliers, I think. But I got rid of the fog lights. It was about the first thing I did. And I then used the four holes that were there and put a little blanking plate on. Anyway, I left the blanking plate on there, worked out about where I wanted my socket, and then drilled through. And I've now removed the blanking plate, because leaving it on there allowed it to cut more of a circle, and we've just got the very ends of the hole that was hacked out for the switch. So that means when that's in place, it does actually cover all of that, and we haven't made any more holes in it. Just happens to be in the right place as well. I'm not quite sure how I'm going to fill these holes yet, if I do at all, but I'm now going to rub this down and give both halves of this a coat of paint. But I just wanted to show you this. I would love to know what's happened to this vehicle in the past, but even this centre console, the little trim strip on it, is all full of mud. Still finding it. Well, it's a bit of a grotty day out there. It's just drizzling, so everything would get wet if I was working out there. And it's quite a nice day to be in the workshop, really. I spent a bit of time yesterday renovating the centre console. It's a bit tidier than what it was, and it'll look better once it's got the hazard and fog light switches cleaned up and refitted. But I'm quite pleased with how that's gone. It's a lot better than what it was. I went to a bit of trouble to refurbish the ammeter, which looks an awful lot better. It had suffered in much the same way as the speedometer, with the sealant that they used on the bezel having crept out and all over the glass. But I've actually decided I'm not going to refit it, and there's a few reasons for that. And the first is that the wiring for it is really bulky, two great big heavy, almost like battery cables, that run up and into the dashboard, and all they do is that ammeter. They feed that, and it frankly doesn't do an awful lot. If I was running radio kit off the truck, which is presumably what was done at some time, it might be useful to see it. But it's really of no practical use to me, and I've decided I'm going to remove it, and it'll give a bit more space behind the dash and in the engine bay. I'll show you those cables, they do actually take up a fair bit of space. And it will give me some space in the dash to be able to run the line to my oil pressure and coolant gauge that I'm going to fit. And not only that, there's already the hole for it in the dashboard, so no more holes to make in the vinyl. So, talking of the new oil pressure gauge, I started to look at the oil filter housing, and I bought this adapter to take the capillary line to the gauge from the filter housing, and I've now realised that the threads between the series filter housing and the 2.5 filter housing are quite different. You can see that the later, the 2.5 17H engine has what appears to be an M10x1 thread, whereas this is Imperial. I suspect it might be a UNC thread, that, looking at it, but anyway. The whole point of fitting the gauge is that I'll be able to keep an eye on the condition of the new engine when that's fitted. So I've decided that I'm going to fit the 17H filter housing to the 2.25 that's in there at the moment, and I might as well just make an adapter to fit so that we know it's all going to work when I go over to the new engine. So I'm going to have to remake one of these, but fortunately we have the technology, so that's all right. I'm otherwise trying to use standard parts. So this is an MGB oil pressure line. It says made in Germany on it, so it's probably quite a good quality, we hope. It's usually a good sign. We've got this little adapter which will go into the side of the adapter fitting that goes in the filter housing, and then we've got a capillary line with the gauge fitting on it, and that is all silver soldered. Again, that's an MGB part. Reason for using MG bits is that they're readily available, and the run from engine block to gauge is roughly the same as what I'm working with here. Anyway, so we better get the lathe going, I think. It's a rather old-fashioned lathe, this one, so we have to change the gears manually. I've got a metric 21 tooth conversion gear for the Myford, so I can do metric threads. The material I'm turning is in 16T, just what I had, but nice and strong. It does mean light cuts. We've got a 60 degree high speed steel threading tool in there. Alright, well, we're just about ready to get thread cutting, so the lead screw's engaged. I've set the gear train as I need it. I like to use a hand crank for doing little threads like this. So let's go, let's make the first cut. Obviously not practical for repetition work, but for accurate one-offs it works rather well. As I say, it's quite a hard material here in 16T, so we'll just take our time. Here on, probably 2 or 3 thou cuts. We are at the right depth now, so let's see if the filter housing threads onto it. That's pretty good. I think I'm happy with that. Suddenly thought, I wonder if I've actually got a M10 by 1 tap, but fortunately I have. It's rather old looking, but I think it might just do the job. Let's see if we can get it started this way and finish it off with a hand wrench. Drill was a T drill, quite useful having letter and number drills. Sometimes get you out of trouble. See if that ancient tap was any good. Quite a nice snug thread actually. I think we're all right. Well, next thing is to pop it on the mill, put a hole in the side of it, 1/8 BSP. thread. I'm going for 8th BSP. I don't want a taper thread, I want to use a copper washer, slightly modify the adapter fitting just to I think get a better result. The BSP taper fitting supplied wasn't really any good. Probably wondering about the ball bearing. The ball bearing's got a flat on it, so with something like this it locates nicely in the countersunk drilling in the end of that fitting. Right, do the rest on the vise, I think. Well, here we are then. Oh, just give it a little bit of a clean up. Cleaned up the face where the sealing wash is going to have to go. I was going to chemical black this, but actually it will just go rusty in time, so I decided that it's going to be better just fitted onto the filter housing and then painted. Got some Loctite 545 hydraulic thread seal. Unfortunately the nozzle on this is about done for, but never mind, it's actually quite a good stuff this. Plenty of it. So I've had to be a bit careful with this to make sure that the takeoff for the gauge pokes out at just the right point. And now the little takeoff fitting. It was a taper thread, but I've run a standard BSP 1/8 inch die down it because I prefer to use the copper washer. Nonetheless, it's still a nice snug thread. That'll do nicely. I'll clean that up a bit more, mask off the brass fitting and give it a squirt of satin black paint, I think. I'm quite pleased with that. And then of course the sender pops in there. Now I know you can actually buy these adapters, you can actually buy one for the fender, but I had all the bits, so why not just make one myself? Kind of one of the satisfactions when you've got the machine tools to do it. There you go, and you can see it doesn't break through into the port, it's just kind of flush with it, so no restriction to oil flow. And then that pipe can go on there, and we'll probably put a little bracket on the engine somewhere, and then we'll need a male to male 1/8 inch union, and we can fix that. Well, we'll have to, that'll have to be to a bracket off the engine, off something that's not moving about. But anyway, there it is, another job done. Well, I think that's gone reasonably well. I've just given that a little lick of paint and looks reasonably smart. I've just ordered a new pressure switch for it as well. They're all of a couple of quid, a filter, gasket and so on. So hopefully next time we might actually be able to bolt that on. I've been trying to think of a reason why I can't refit the steering box, and I can't think of anything. So hopefully next time you'll see that as well, weather permitting. And yeah, we can actually get back to the intended subject of these videos, because I appreciate we have deviated somewhat. But it's just a case of doing all the improvements I can while I'm in there. Anyway, I think all that remains is to wish you a happy Christmas, and I hope that the new year ahead will be a slightly better one than this year, but we'll see. It is what you make of it, I suppose. Anyway, we'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.